Today, we have Evan Marwell of Education Superhighway and Tom Cohen, outside counsel to ACA Connects, together to discuss a joint filing regarding the Emergency Connectivity Fund. Pens down, boys. Time to discuss. Evan, Tom, welcome to the show.
Great to be here.
We're here talking about how the FCC should design the Emergency Connectivity Fund, also called the ECF. For use during the emergency of COVID, this new program makes available $7.2 billion to eligible schools and libraries so that they may purchase broadband service and connected devices for students, school staff, and library patrons at locations other than a school or a library. As we speak today, Monday, April 26th, the FCC has until May 10th to adopt final rules. That's just 2 weeks away. What do you both see as the big challenges that the FCC faces in creating these rules?
Well, first, thanks for having me on the show. I think the number one thing is that, you know, Congress really put in place the ECF in order to close the homework gap, in order to make sure that 10 to 15 million students and library patrons on top of that, that don't have internet access and don't have an educational device, can actually participate in remote learning and use technology even once they go back to school. So I think the biggest challenge the FCC has is to make sure that the funds do as much as possible to close the homework gap.
Well, and building on what Evan said, is this is quite extraordinary what Congress has done here. I mean, $7 billion. This is, you know, what E-Rate spends in what, 4 years or something like that. So they're really focused on a critical task, concerns about remote learning. And so it's really impressive they put this together. The key now is the implementation.
So Evan, Education Superhighway has been focused for nearly a decade on upgrading internet access in every public school classroom in America. How does your work on that mission help inform what is trying to be achieved with the ECF?
Well, it's a great point. So as you said, you know, over the last decade, we've helped connect 99% of the schools in America to high-speed broadband. And you know, one of the things we heard about all the time was the homework gap, the fact that kids had the ability to use digital learning in school, but probably, you know, 30% of them would go home and wouldn't have the same tools at their disposal in terms of being able to use digital learning to help them with their homework. And that really put them at a disadvantage. And the pandemic made it really clear just how much of a disadvantage those students were at. As I said before, roughly 10 to 15 million students were sent home without internet access at the start of the pandemic, and probably somewhere between 7 and 12 million of them still don't have internet access, despite incredible efforts by industry and school districts and states. So I think what we learned from the first go around trying to connect the schools is that the way you solve this problem is through a public-private partnership. And you need the public part of it to provide the funding to make sure that we can actually afford to connect all these folks. But you need the private part of it to help figure out who is and isn't connected, who can connect them, and then to actually get the work done to get service to each of those folks. So this is all about public-private partnership again. And you know, that's why we've been excited to work with ACA Connects on our Bridge to Broadband program, and now on the ECF.
So speaking of public-private partnership, last Friday, Education Superhighway, ACA Connects, the Benton Institute for Broadband and Society, and NTCA, the Rural Broadband Association, joined together to urge the FCC to adopt four measures. A copy of this letter is pasted below. The signatories of the letter have different views on many issues, including some within the ECF proceeding, but these differences were set aside to team up for this letter. Why did you choose to join the joint? Why did you choose to file the joint letter, Tom?
Well, I think this FCC proceeding is incredibly compressed. You've got 60 days. Unlike normal, Ross, where you and I may do something for 6-9 months and help, you know, work towards it, the FCC has to converge very quickly on solutions. And if various stakeholders coming from different viewpoints come together, that could be really helpful for the FCC.
Thanks.
So,
yeah, I agree. You know, I think that especially when we have a 2-2 commission, it's really important to show as much unity as possible on the key issues that they're going to need to resolve. And I think having, you know, industry and, you know, education groups come together on some of the key principles, I think is going to be really helpful in guiding their decisions.
So the group's first ask is that the FCC prioritize the funding requests from schools and libraries. That is to ensure the needs of students and library patrons meeting certain criteria are met before those of others. Why is this important, and what were your recommendations?
Well, I mean, the fact of the matter is, despite the fund being $7.2 billion, there isn't enough money. You know, there are, as I said, 10 to 15 million kids that don't have internet at home. And there are probably about 8 million kids who still don't have a connected learning device. So you can imagine very quickly that that money is going to run out, especially if we don't spend it effectively. And so the first ask from the four groups that signed onto the letter was to prioritize the funding for those who are unconnected. And by that, we mean either a student who doesn't have an internet connection at home, a student who doesn't have a connected learning device, or a student who has an internet connection at home, but only because their school is currently paying for it. And so I think, you know, when we do the analysis, if it's very easy to blow through that $7.2 billion in a very short order of time, without even achieving the goal of getting the unconnected connected. So it's really important that we focus on the unconnected and not waste money paying for people who have a device or who have internet access at home.
You know, Ross, let me just build on what Evan said.
Sure.
Because the statute gives the FCC a lot of room to maneuver. It talks in general about connectivity and related devices, modems and routers, but it also talks in terms of connected devices, computers. And then the time period starts at the beginning of the emergency, January 2020, and then it goes through whenever the emergency ends. So Evan's right, within those, you know, you take those broad bounds, boy, money can be used up fast. And the idea is to help the FCC say, let's set priorities. And I think that's the key to this letter, is helping the commission stay in focus. Let's make sure kids get connected who aren't connected during the emergency. And so, you know, the other point was, let's prioritize money going forward. So we make sure, you know, kids who can't learn in 2022 or 2021, 22, whenever the emergency goes, can still get it. Then if there's money left over, then you can go back.
Is the expectation that there might be a significant amount of expenses that looking backwards to January 2020?
I mean, there could be. Many schools did this on their own, or they did it in partnership with Evan. Some did it with government money, CARES Act money, or other money out there. Or others did it because they had the resources, which in a sense says those who didn't have resources just couldn't do this at all, which, you know, goes to the point of equity about if you look back. And so it could, you know, churn, you know, through a lot of money very quickly.
Yeah, our analysis suggests that it's well north of $1 billion that's already been spent. We know governors using their CARES Act money allocated $1.8 billion for devices and connectivity. And then, of course, school districts had access to a lot more money than that from the CARES Act in both the first and second bill. So, you know, we could easily see anywhere from, you know, a fifth to half of the fund used up on day one if the FCC decides to allow retrospective use of the funding.
Yeah. So the idea is there's needs now, there's going to be needs going forward. Let's meet those needs before we look backwards and refill the coffers of those who are already spent.
That's right.
So you raised concerns that expenditures on connected devices such as laptops and tablets could quickly eat up the program's budget as well. Why do you have this concern, and what are your proposed solutions?
Yeah, so there's two things we're worried about. So, you know, we estimate, based on a lot of work that was done by BCG early in the pandemic, that there are probably still as many as eight and a half million students without a connected device. And if you think about it, you know, if people start buying MacBooks, because we've got 100% reimbursement from the fund, that's $8 billion right there. And unfortunately, we don't want to, well, not unfortunately, the reality is that, you know, devices are going to be the easiest thing for school districts to buy, right? It's very easy to just send out a purchase order, get the devices, as opposed to the work that has to be done to figure out who doesn't have an internet connection, which provider can serve them, getting them signed up for the service, getting it installed. It's sort of the path of least resistance. And so what we're worried about is that, you know, devices could easily suck up all the funds, because school districts are probably thinking to themselves, okay, there's a limited amount of money, I need to get as much as I possibly can, and so I'm going to focus on devices first. And so we don't want to end up in a situation where those 8 million kids have devices and none of them have internet at home, because then what's the point of getting them devices? And so our recommendation in the letter was that the FCC limit the amount that can be spent on devices, both overall, but also on a per device basis. And I think there's a fair amount of consensus that, you know, $500, you know, is probably a good cap level. And there are numbers that vary, but we certainly don't want people, you know, buying $1,000 MacBooks for folks.
Sounds like we're talking Chromebooks and not MacBooks, right?
Actually, people had lower caps. Some were, you know, as Evan said, 300, something less. You know, what's interesting, Evan used the term consensus. And I think, you know, Ross, I went through, started this morning, the reply comments that came in on Friday. And there really is, to me, some convergence about, yeah, we've got limited money. We probably almost everybody wants to say, let's just use it going forward, establish that as the priority. I think a lot of people are out there as well as, you know, we need to make sure the money goes to in-need students, as Evan said, the unconnected, maybe rural. There needs to be cap limits. And I think so what I'm seeing is in this rush to get this done, convergence on a lot of things in a program that's in so many ways novel.
So lastly, you've suggested that the commission should make all procurement data related to the fund transparent and publicly available. What will this help achieve?
Yeah, essentially what we've said to the commission is you need to follow the same rules that you have for the E-rate program, which is all the data about who buys what from whom and at what price is publicly available. And the commission needs this for a couple of reasons. The first is to make sure that the funds get used as effectively as possible. When school districts and others can, other applicants can see what people are paying for things, it helps them be better buyers. But the second thing, and in some ways the more important thing, is look, the homework gap's not going to end in when the ECF funding ends. And we're going to need a permanent solution to this. And if we don't have good data coming out of this experiment about what does it take to actually close the homework gap, it's going to be really hard for the commission and others to make the case to Congress about setting up a permanent program to deal with this. So, data is really important for making sure that the money gets spent well, for tracking our progress against closing the homework gap, and for making the case for the future.
So Tom, what comes next now?
It's a race. We have 2 weeks till an FCC order, roughly May 10. And so already people knowing that were coming in for meetings with the, you know, staff with the eighth floor. And I expect it to be sort of hot and heavy over the next couple of weeks as, you know, people go in to make their points. Again, to what Ross, you and Evan have done in trying to pull together a disparate group, I think there's real value in that, continuing to show the commission that there really is a consensus developing of how this should work.
Evan, any final thoughts?
Well, it's a game changer for students out there. This is an incredible opportunity to really make huge progress if we implement it correctly. So my thoughts are, I hope the FCC listens to the consensus that's emerging and puts in place rules that allow us to not only make a lot of progress today, but make the case to Congress for making this kind of a program permanent.
Yeah, I think that's definitely, I hear you there. There's a lot of different views on this program, but there definitely is consensus that there's a problem out there that needs to be addressed. And it's been a pleasure to work with you, Evan, on this letter, and to continue working with you on these issues. So thank you, Evan. Thank you, Tom. If you've liked what you just watched, please leave comments. Thank you for joining us, and look soon for the next episode of Just Filed.